Good morning, Community Covenant Church.
Good morning.
Good morning to you. We're going to talk about the love of God this morning and how much He loves us. Will you please stand and join together as we start our worship service with a song? We'll start this morning with How He Loves.
Like a hurricane, I am a tree, bending the knee, the weight of His wind and mercy. And all of a sudden, I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful You are and how great Your affection are for me. Oh, how He loves us so. Oh, how He loves us. How He loves us so.
Sing it from the top again. He is jealous for me.
He is jealous for me. Loves like a hurricane. I am a tree, bending beneath the weight of His wind and mercy. And all of a sudden, I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory. And I realize just how beautiful You are and how great Your affections are for me. Oh, how He loves us so. Oh, how He loves us. How He loves us so. Redemption by the grace in His eyes. If His grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. So heaven meets earth like a sloppy wet kiss, and my heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know how much You love us by the life and the death and the resurrection of Your Son, Jesus. He is the one who taught us when praying to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Well, good morning again and welcome to worship this Lord's Day. We're glad to have you and we hope today will be a blessing for all. You have a wonderfully full bulletin in front of you, and I'll let you make sure you read through all of the opportunities you have to join us for fellowship and service. The one highlight I want to have is for your insert, because we are doing a Discovery 101 class, which is a class for us to review the history of our church, the doctrines that have formed our denomination and so forth. This is a great opportunity to learn about our church, and if you have been to it once, you might want to go to again. And we like to have a group of about 6 to 8 people who attend this, and we would love for you to register your attendance with us so that we know how much to purchase for the lunch that follows. As you can see before us, our communion table is set, and we like to remind everyone that ours is an open communion table, and that means that anyone who names Jesus as Lord and Savior is welcome to participate in this sacrament at the end of the hour. It's also our custom on Communion Sundays to take a special offering for our benevolent fund. You'll find a separate tray available if you'd like to donate to this private crisis fund for people in and around our congregation. And I have a notice. I forgot in the first hour to tell you guys that you need to register your attendance with us. Thank you. I didn't even know it until just now. Appreciate it, Dana. But there are black folders on the inside aisle of your pew, and we'd really like it if you would sign them and then just pass them down the road to the next person. Thank you.
Let's continue to worship and sing of the love of God this morning. Will you please stand and join together? We'll sing, we'll worship the King.
Worship the King, how glorious above, and gratefully sing His wonderful love. How sheer and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilion in splendor and girded with praise.
Tell of His might,
tell of His might, we'll sing of His grace. With robes the light in canopy space, with chains of wrath, the deep thunder clouds fall, and darkens His path on the wings of the storm.
So you alone,
you alone are the matchless King. To you alone be our majesty. Your glories and wonders were tongue can decide. We breathe in the air, shine in the light. Measureless might, ineffable love, our angels delight to worship above. Thy mercies now tender, upward to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
You alone,
you alone are the matchless King. To you alone be our majesty. Your glories and wonders for tongue can recite. We breathe in the air, shine in the light.
You alone,
for you alone are the matchless King. To you alone be our majesty. Your glories and wonders, what tongue can recite? You breathe in the air, you shine in the light, shine in the light, you shine in the light. We worship the King, how glorious above, and gratefully sing His wonders.
been walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to, the same old holes inside. There's a better life, there's a better life. If you got paid, the pain taken. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. You need freedom, saving. He's a prison shaking sailor. You got chains. I'll search for the light of day in the dead of night. We all find ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run, hey, you know it, just stay right. There's a better life, there's a better life. You got pain, there's a pain taker. You feel all. Shaking Savior, he got chains, he's a chain breaker. You believe it, you believe it, you receive it, you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, you receive it. If you can feel it, somebody testify. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, you're saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains. He's a chain breaker. Oh, he's a freedom saving. He's a prison shaking savior. He got chains. He's a chain breaker. He's our king. Let's sing to him. Oh, kneel me down again here at your feet. Show me how much you love humility. Oh, Spirit, be the star.
Thank you.
Take a seat.
We will pray for our offering now. You may give to the tray beside the door, and you can also give online at carneycovenant.com/giving. Let's pray. Father, we know that your Son gave everything for us, and that we have been invited to follow in his steps and to give everything we have to you. Lord, make us good stewards. Make us remember that everything we have does belong to you, and receive this offering now and use it to extend your kingdom on earth. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Stopping at another red light, a man with a sign wants my money and time. But I decide he'll probably buy a beer, probably doesn't even live here, probably has a house with a pool. But I'm just making excuses. Love your neighbor doesn't ask me if I fully understand, doesn't ask if he's a working kind of man. Love your neighbor is a little about him, probably more about me, but it's a lot about you. Love is a lot about you. God, you know she used to be a friend, but that came to an end when the truth began to bend. She lied to me, I guess she broke my heart. I don't know how to start letting this go. It's just so hard to forgive. Love your enemy doesn't ask me if she has apologized, doesn't ask me if I see things through her eyes. Love your enemy is a little about her, probably more about me, but it's a lot about you. Love is a lot about you. You want me to finally be a reflection of you, and you are love. You want me to finally be a reflection of you, and you are love. Love your neighbor doesn't ask me if I fully understand. Love your neighbor doesn't ask if he's a working kind of man. Love your neighbor doesn't ask me if she has apologized. Love your neighbor doesn't ask me if I see things through her eyes. Love your neighbor is a little about them, probably more about me, but it's a lot about you. Love is a lot about you.
If you're following in your own Bible, you can turn now to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. This month marks a notorious anniversary, and I'm sure you'll be hearing about it in the news, but it was on February 28th of 1993 that the Waco siege began. 30 years ago, a group of federal agents surrounded a religious commune called the Branch Davidians, and there was a great gunfight. People died. 51 days of siege lay ahead, and there were inside that compound 75 people who were willing to die, willing to give their bodies to the flames, and they did. And it was a horrific inferno that followed. Now, there were a lot of speculation as to how that happened, why it happened, and how it could have been avoided, but I just want to make a single point. The leader of that group was a man named David Koresh, and Koresh convinced his followers that he could work spectacular miracles, that he could do signs and wonders, and they believed it. And then he taught that every one of them could do these amazing miracles that everyone would be able to see. And in his frustration, he ultimately said that if you don't do these tremendous miracles, you are not a Christian at all. Now, in the passage that we've been studying, we know that the truth is exactly the opposite. The Apostle Paul says, you might do miracles. You might move mountains. You might even give your bodies to the flames, but that doesn't prove anything. You can do great things for God and not have God at all. So let's read again. Verse 1 and following. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to the flames but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it is not rude. It is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. And when I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Well, this is the fourth week of a long reflection on some of the most famous words in the Bible, and we're studying them over and over again to unlearn some of the misconceptions that are commonly thought about this passage. The original hearers did not hear this as an inspirational pep talk. It was a tough correction for a very stubborn and proud congregation. The church in Corinth was a big church in a boom town. It was filled with talented people, lots of resources, and lots of things were going on. But the miracle above all miracles, love, was absent. This was a church that was missing love. Paul does not tell us to be loving. He tells us what love is. Love is something so perfect that it never fails. And that means that if we ever give up on someone we love, we never really loved them in the first place. The only reason that we would ever give up on someone that we loved was because they stopped giving us the thing we really loved, because they stopped providing us the thing that we were really after. And maybe it was affection or respect or gratitude or compliance or physical pleasure, but you'd only ever give up on someone if what you really wanted wasn't coming through them any longer. There's an old fable about a farmer who loved his king, and he really loved his king. And so in the harvest one year, he found the largest and most perfect carrot that he had ever seen before. And he thought, this is a carrot fit for my king. And so it was his great joy to pack that up and carry this carrot to his king. And he said, my king, this is the greatest carrot that I have ever produced or ever will produce, and it is my joy to present it to you. And then, as he was leaving, the king said, wait, you have delighted me. From now on, I will double the portion of your land. And the farmer went away rejoicing. Well, there was a nobleman who heard this conversation, this exchange, and he thought, man, if the king would do that for a carrot, what would he do for a horse? And so he went home to his stables, and he picked out his finest horse, and he led the horse to the king, and he said, my king, this is the greatest horse that I have ever bred or ever will breed. It's my joy to present this horse to you. And the king said, take your horse and get out of my sight. Now the nobleman said, I don't understand. Isn't a horse better than a carrot? The king said, that farmer gave me the carrot. You gave yourself that horse. The farmer gave strictly out of love, strictly for the joy of loving his king. He didn't expect something in return, but the nobleman didn't give the horse in joy. He gave the horse in trade. He was hoping for something better. The farmer loved the king, but the nobleman loved himself. I have to take a look at myself and ask myself, why do I pray? And why do I come to church? And why do I give? Is it so that I can get a good life here on earth? Is it so that God will answer my prayers the way I want him to? Is it so that I can get into heaven? Because if that's the case, then I'm not really loving God for who he is. I'm using God. I'm using God as an instrument, and I don't really have a personal relationship with him. True love is an end all by itself. I will love someone for who they are. And that definition of love is crushing to me because I can't do it. Not in my fallen nature. In my fallen nature, I can't love somebody that purely. It's what we all need. It's what we all want. We hate it when somebody loves us simply for what we can provide for them. We feel dehumanized. We feel used. We all require this. We are angry when we get used like this. but we can't do it for others. And when we realize how inaccessible it is, we are broken. I can't love like that, but there is someone who can, and there is someone who did. And that's why Paul uses personification in order to describe love. Love is Jesus. Jesus did love us. Jesus is kind. Jesus does not envy. Jesus does not boast and all the rest. Jesus never fails. And when you fully experience that, you begin to change. When you ponder that, it exposes your false love. And when you receive that, when you receive this unending source of love, it can overflow to other people. The Apostle John said it very simply, we love because he first loved us. We love because his love came into us first. We can't love until we experience his love. Now, so far in this series, we have discussed the definition of love. We have discussed how this kind of love transforms our relationship with God. We've talked about how this love transforms our relationship with ourselves. And today, we're talking about how this love transforms our relationships with each other. What is going to happen to our relationships when this love comes into our lives? Well, the key is verse 6. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Now, there's an interesting little tension among translators with this little word, with. If you look at other versions, depending on which one you're using, your Bible might say that love rejoices in the truth, or loves the truth, or insists on the truth. The translators struggled because they didn't know how could love rejoice with the truth. And I'm glad the NIV, which we most commonly use here, the NIV just translated it exactly as it is, and they didn't speculate on trying to interpret it for you. Love rejoices with the truth, and that means that the truth was already rejoicing. The truth is already has a rejoicing of its own. And sometimes the word truth just means factual information, just truth in general. But in this case, this is the truth of God, the truth of God's word, the truth of the gospel, and there is a truth that is already rejoicing. The Bible says God is love, and Jesus said, I am the truth. And Jesus said, the truth will set you free. Love and truth always go together, and they always rejoice together. When you meet real love, it's going to expose false love. It's going to reveal the kind of love you had before. And love and truth will rejoice together. They sing the same song. Love brings us to truth. Truth brings us to love. Love does not delight in evil. It refuses to let somebody do evil for their own sake. When you see someone doing evil, you will confront them. When you see someone hurting themselves or hurting something that God loves, you will step in. You will speak truth. But you will only ever do it without rudeness, without pride, and with complete patience and kindness. We will tell the truth in love, Ephesians 4:15. Without the grace of God, you could be patient and kind, but you won't confront. Or you could be very confrontational, but you won't be patient and kind. If you're the patient and kind person who hates to confront, it's because you don't really love that person for their own sake. You are patient and kind because you want their approval. And you want them to not be upset with you. On the other hand, if you're confronting them and you tend to do it with rudeness and harshness, abrasiveness, well, you're still not loving them for their own sake either. You're not thinking of them, you're thinking of yourself, and you're getting it off your chest so you can feel better. Only when you experience Jesus's loving you utterly for who you are, can you begin to love others utterly for who they are. And only when you experience your deepest needs for approval being met by God's approval will you be free from the need of approval from other people. Truth without love isn't truth. And love without truth isn't love. Love and truth sing together. And Jesus is both the melody and the lyrics. When you receive Jesus Christ, you sing a completely new song. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. Now, even though we have a new nature, we still have the old flesh, and the old flesh has a memory of that false sense of love. And if we rejoice in the truth, we have to stop rejoicing in falsehood, and the Bible says we have to do some work. We have to put some effort in this. We need to get rid of it. 1 Peter 2:1 says, therefore, rid yourself of all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and slander of every kind. The Greek word is apothesis. It means to completely cut out the old nature, to completely get rid of it and to put it to death. In Colossians 3, Paul said, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. 1 Corinthians 13 is the centerpiece of three chapters on spiritual gifts. And Paul is not opposed to spiritual gifts. He loves spiritual gifts, but it's got to be qualified in love. And so these three chapters speak to the gift that God gives to each one of us and then calls us together to operate in harmony and cooperation. The body of Christ is made with each of our bodies. We come and we bring our individual bodies here to form one body. Romans 6:13 says, do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer the parts of your body to Him as instruments of righteousness. Our bodies are the tools of service to God. And we each have a spiritual gift that God gives to us in order to contribute to this body and to grow ourselves. And our witness to the world is how well we cooperate, how well we work together. Love is the miracle above all miracles, and love rejoices with the truth. The world watches. The world sees how we work together. And we must be lovers of the truth. Ephesians 4:23 says that we are made new in the attitudes of our minds. The Greek word ananeo is to recreate. When you become a Christian, God gives you a new mind, a brand new fresh start, but now you are to fill it with new things. You are to fill it with truth and love. And that's why the Bible says this in Philippians 4:8, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable. If anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. To grow the new nature, a Christian must fill ourselves with love and truth. Love and truth will go together always. We need to know the difference between what is beautiful and what is ugly, what is right, what is wrong, what is good, and what is bad. And our new nature needs to grow in the place of what was there before. You don't just stop a bad habit. You have to start a new habit. You don't just stop something and leave a void behind. You have to fill it. For instance, in Ephesians 4:28, Paul says, stop stealing and start working. You kill the desire to steal by getting a job and being responsible for your own life. Do something positive with the time that you used to use for something negative. Now, One of my favorite sentences in 1 Corinthians is in chapter 8, verse 1. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. We need to know love by experience. And by that experience, we can build our love. We can build our life on it. Knowledge is good, but it can lack wisdom. And knowledge can lead to pride. Only love builds our character and our community. Ephesians chapter 4 is one of my favorite passages in Scripture because it's very practical and it has great psychology to it. There is a practicality to exchanging falsehood for truth. Paul will say to stop using foul language, you need a new vocabulary. You don't merely shut your mouth. You don't merely be silent. You start being constructive. You speak love and truth. Paul says that you replace bitterness and rage and anger and slander, and what you put in the void left behind is compassion and kindness and forgiveness. Something has to grow in the old space. You stop sinning and you start doing good. And one of the key things that we need to replace is in verse 25, therefore each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. Stop lying and tell the truth. In verse 15 earlier, Paul said, speaking the truth in love, we grow. We grow as a church. And now verse 25, he says that we do this because we are members of one body. As a body, we share the truth in love because it builds the body. It's not the peacekeeping kind of truth where we avoid unpleasant things to say. Telling the truth in love may mean that we have to say some very unpleasant things. We might have to tell a brother that his language is not giving glory to God. Or we might have to tell a sister that the TV show that she's watching is not enhancing, not edifying her life. We also need to preserve our love for each other. In verse 26, Paul said, in your anger, do not sin. In your anger, do not sin. That means that anger isn't necessarily a sin. Earlier in 1 Corinthians 13, Paul said, love is not easily angered. How do we know if our anger is righteous or a sin? Well, I like that the Greeks were a little more, they had a bigger vocabulary than English-speaking people do. And so there are three Greek words that are translated simply as anger in English, but they mean different things. There is a word that is thumos that is often translated, or it means to have an outrage, to burst out. And there's a word paragismos, it means to have bitterness inside of ourselves. And then there is a word for anger, orge, that means to have a settled conviction. To have a settled conviction against evil is a good thing. To have a settled conviction to protect your children is a good thing. To have a settled conviction that you don't want to let somebody hurt themselves or hurt somebody else. Okay? There is a duty, a Christian duty, to manage our anger so that it is orge, a settled conviction, and not let it turn into rage or a quiet bitterness. And there's only one way to do this, and that's through practice, by telling the truth to each other. Love rejoices with the truth, and it's not always fun, and it's not always easy, but it's the only way that we can function truly as a body. Righteous anger, if it's orge, if it's a settled conviction, it's going to seek a positive resolution every single time. When you're angry at a brother, orge means you're going to go to the brother. You're going to work it out. And Paul says, get on with it. In Ephesians 4, 26 and 27, Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Paul uses a word to describe the devil here, diabolos, which means slanderer. And if your anger is unchecked, if your anger is allowed to grow, it will turn into slander, either in your mind or it'll come out of your mouth and you'll slander someone. Very often, bitterness or frustration will grow into the form of slandering, which means to tell a third party, to share your side of the story with somebody else. And it begins to grow. It begins to expand. Jesus gave very careful instruction on how to constructively resolve personal conflict. Matthew 18, beginning at verse 15. If your brother sins against you, go and show him his fault just between the two of you. If he listens to you, you've won your brother over. But if he will not listen, take one or two others along so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen to the church, treat him as you would a pagan or a tax collector. Conflicts need to be addressed quickly and privately. They may not get resolved quickly, but they need to be acknowledged quickly. Difficult tensions don't normally go away on their own. They tend to fester, and they result in imagination and conspiracy theories about what's going on, and sooner or later it'll leak out in the form of a major conflict or telling a third party. Now here's my last point. Love makes peace. We can't love until we have experienced love, and then we practice what was done for us. We have peace with the Father because Jesus came and he suffered for that peace. He made peace between us and God. Now, as we approach the Lord's table, we remember his suffering. We approach the Lord's table for the miracle of the sacrament. And one of the reasons that Paul wrote 1 Corinthians 13 is for the conflicts that he described in 1 Corinthians 11. To back up a couple of chapters, you'll see that he was especially troubled with the practice of communion in Corinth, because there were divisions and there was bitterness and frustration and anger toward people that was going unresolved. But it was at this table that Jesus made this peace, that Jesus told us that the world will know you by your love. And the miracle above all miracles is love. And this is what Jesus was facing when he was praying for us, when he told us that story. He knew that one of his friends was going to betray him. He knew that all the other friends were going to scatter and run for their lives. He knew that he was about to be brutalized and tortured and killed. And what did he do about it? He washed the disciples' feet. He ate and drank with them. He prayed for them and he blessed them. And Jesus is here now to bless us. We are here now to bless each other. We have to examine ourselves before we eat this bread and drink this cup. Here is the warning that Paul gives in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 27. So then whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. And if you want a scarier version of that, read the King James Version. They eat and drink damnation on themselves. Now, we don't come to this table as perfect people. We come as people in process. You and I have some unfinished business in this world, and some of it is relational. If you're unwilling to be reconciled to someone, If you're holding deep-seated bitterness against someone, if you're not willing to go through the process with Jesus, then don't come to the table. Don't take communion. Don't bring judgment on yourself. This is a very serious warning. However, if you're in conflict now, that doesn't disqualify you from communion. It is communion that you need. If you're willing to forgive, then communion will bring you power. If you're willing to make peace through both love and truth, then come to the table. You check your heart in these next moments of silence as we do every month. Please bow your heads. I want you to pray in silence. Let God speak to you, and whatever he says, you say yes. And if you say yes, you're invited to the table. Friends, it is now our sacred privilege to celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. All who humbly put their trust in Christ and desire his help that they may lead a holy life, all who are truly sorry for their sins and would be delivered from them, all who would walk in love with their neighbors and intend to live a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from now on in his holy ways, are invited to draw near with faith and receive this holy sacrament. Come to this sacred table, not because you must, but because you may. Come not to testify that you are righteous, but that you sincerely love your Lord Jesus and desire to be his true disciples. Come not because you are strong, but because you are weak, and not because you have any claim on the grace of God, but because in your frailty and your sin, you stand in constant need of his mercy and help. Come not to express an opinion, but to seek God's presence and pray for the Spirit. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he gathered his disciples, and during a meal, he took bread and he blessed it, and breaking it, he said, "This is my body, broken for you. You eat this in my memory." In the same way, after supper, he took a cup and he blessed it, and showing it to them, he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. You drink this in my memory." And we're instructed that whenever we eat this bread and whenever we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. Let's pray. O Lord of all, we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this cup. Gracious God, we pray that you'll send your Holy Spirit on these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and the blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his death and resurrection, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us to that heavenly feast where with all your saints we will be gathered in glory for everlasting, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Friends, if you are using a sanitary communion kit, you may take and eat. This is the body of Christ. This is the blood of the new covenant. If you prefer, you may come forward and I'll serve you in front of the altar. Let's pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may stand for a benediction. Jesus said, "I have come that you might have life abundantly. Go in peace, and may your abundant life in Christ overflow in deeds of love and service. Amen."